We welcome you to Bayou Baptist Church this morning on this July the 8th. I hope everyone had a good 4th of July and a very safe one as well. So we do welcome each and every one to Bayou Baptist Church this morning. Let's all stand as Al comes and leads us in our call to worship and opening prayer.
Turn to hymn number 14. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, He is our health and salvation. All you give, now to His temple draw near. Praise Him in adoration.
We are climbing Jacob's ladder.
That's good. That's awesome. Prayers of Thanksgiving. Good. Ginger.
Just continue, but also, as Renee said, from our family members.
Sure.
And also, I don't know if you forget, you remember Lydia from First Baptist.
No, that's what she was telling me about, First Baptist of Araby.
Yeah, she lost her dad. I don't remember the last name, her last name, but she and Amanda were good friends, and I think they both got baptized there at First Baptist Araby.
Okay.
At one time when my sister was alive, she attended the service when Amanda got baptized.
Okay, yes.
And also for Amanda has a friend whose son is 12 years old, and he has some type of cancer. They thought they had gotten rid of it and is back full speed ahead. He's only 12 years old, little boy.
Okay.
His name is
Preston.
And again with cancer, Haley, remember Haley? What's going on with her? They did operate on her for brain cancer.
Right. Okay.
And
we'll do so. Absolutely, yes. We'll do that. Absolutely. Other prayer requests? Any others? Or anyone else? Or anything else? For anybody else? Again, just pray for those who are not here with us. We do have quite a few out on this side here, because you can see the shift. But you feel like I'm trying to meet it on this way.
Well, my weight takes some.
I ain't touching that one. I'd get myself in trouble.
No, you wouldn't.
I need your help. But just pray for those who are not here with us for whatever reason, maybe going like Al mentioned, some are working and some are sick and some things else are going on. But just pray for the different ones who are not going on. That's not here.
Well, we know Victor and Cynthia are supposed to be
off. Yeah, you're talking about that. Yeah, Victor and Cynthia are in Texas or maybe coming back today, because I know he had this week off.
Yeah.
I knew that.
Yeah, I know they've gone off for the whole week.
Okay, so he's probably traveling back today from Texas, and he probably has to get back to work tomorrow. And they're always going up that way. So, yes. So, traveling mercies for Vic and Cynthia.
My sisters are heading back to Georgia today.
Okay, going back to Georgia.
Yeah, they've been close to a month here and close to a month there.
So they go back and forth? Is that what they do?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, they spend a time together.
Okay.
When they come back, Rita's son, his family will come back with
him
in a couple
of
weeks.
Okay. Now
here.
Okay. So it's Rita and Jean, that's Al's two sisters.
Okay.
Now, are they staying together, or are they just...
Yeah, basically, you know, they go and stay over in Georgia for a while.
Okay.
Come out and stay here a while.
Okay. Well, that's good.
Yeah.
That's good. I'm glad they have that relationship, and that's good.
Yeah.
That is awesome. So just remember them in prayer. Any others? Anything else or anyone else? Just pray for our country. Continue to pray for our country and the things that go on. It's a never-ending cycle. It seems like everything comes up. There's always something going on. It seems like every day, not just with the president, but just in our country, period, with the people in places of power and authority and what goes on within our country as well. Traveling mercies for the many who travel back and forth to work during the course of the week. Pray for them as well. Back and forth to New Orleans or Mandeville, Covington area, Metairie area, wherever they travel. Traveling mercies for the many. Pray for our young people today. Remember them in prayer and pray for them. Many changes go on, many things take place, and this affects more of our young people than it does some of us sometimes. So pray for our young people and just remember them also. Pray for each other and reach out in prayer. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. You got some, Ginger?
Yeah, I just wanted to say to keep remembering those four boys in the cave, stuck in that cave.
Yeah, two of them got out.
Two of them got out?
Yeah, two of them they rescued out, and so they're going to be long process. They got experienced Navy SEAL divers going underneath.
It takes like, what, 6 hours?
5 to 6 hours just to get them out of there. They do have two of them that they did get out. Unfortunately, of course, last week one Navy SEAL person was killed because of lack of oxygen coming back. But they do have two of them, so they are in the process now. So yes, so pray for those little boys and even the coach and all the people involved with the rescue efforts that are taking place with that. We sure do. Let's go, Lord, and pray. Almighty God, as we come before you again, Lord, we lift up all the prayers, all the concerns, the many things that are going on in our lives. We pray for the many, many people that are dealing with different health issues and health problems. Some are here, some at home, and Lord, and others maybe even in nursing homes. We lift them all up, and we pray for strength, guidance, and your help upon them. We pray for the many that are going through difficulties, whatever may be going on, work, at home, and even the struggles and the battles we have within ourselves. Some are fighting depression, and we pray and we lift them up and we ask for your help and for your grace and your mercy upon each and every one. For the efforts and for what's taking place to rescue these boys and this coach from this cave, we pray for all involved with that. You'll be with them in that effort and what goes on with that. We lift up again all the prayer requests and all of the concerns that have been voiced and also unspoken as well. We lift up Jennifer, who is in MD Anderson process of trying to figure out if they can help her or what goes on with the tumors that she has on her spine. We lift her and the family up in prayer. We pray for traveling mercies for those who are traveling, will be traveling. Cynthia and Victor, if they'll be traveling back or are traveling back to Texas, be with them and watch over them. Even during the course of the week, others that will be traveling back and forth to work or in and around the city, we pray for traveling mercies and for help and guidance upon them. Again, for others, Mr. Billy Lynchard and his family, continue to be with them and help them as well. Again, others that have been mentioned, we do lift them all up and pray for them and ask for your help. Be with Linda as she takes care of her mom, Miss Virginia Hall. Be with her and Danny and the family as well. We lift up other families that are going through difficulties. Be with them, help them, and watch over them. Lord, we pray for the many, many people that do not know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. We pray for salvation, a friend, a co-worker, a relative, or even a stranger. We pray for salvation for many in need of Jesus Christ in their hearts and in their lives. We thank you for your many, many blessings you bestowed upon us. We thank you for helping us and for being with us. And thanks most of all for sending your Son, Jesus, to die on the cross for our sins. Be with us now. Lead us and guide us. In the name of Jesus, we ask it. Amen. Let us stand as Al comes now and leads us in our offertory hymn.
217, Oh, How I Love Jesus. There is a name.
Oh, how I love Jesus.
again, we come before you. We thank you for your many blessings. We thank you for seeing to our needs. We thanks for all that you have done for us and are doing in our lives. We come now, Lord, and we give you back a portion of what you have blessed us with. And we ask, Lord, that you will see to it that all is collected is used for the furtherance of your kingdom, for the spreading of the gospel. And Lord, may you bless both the gift and the giver. In the name of Jesus. Amen.
Understand that in the secular realm today.
And so today let us look and read about this strange sight and also the conversation between Jehovah God and Moses and what God reveals to him when he's 80 years old. And understand that how God uses ordinary things. Just going to give you an example. One day back in 1850, it was a cold January Sunday morning, bitterly cold in England. There was a hard blizzard, and he kept many of the worshipers home. We understand that. When we get a little bit cold, people stay home. It doesn't take much for people to stay home. A little bit of rain and people stay home as well. But hey, that's up to them. But this was a bitter, blizzarding cold. And it was in England, a primitive Methodist chapel, and only about a dozen people showed up. Not only that, not even the pastor showed up. He couldn't even get up. That's how bad it probably was. So what happened is, up in the pulpit, there was an uneducated deacon or an uneducated man gets up, and he spoke very hesitantly on Isaiah 45 and verse 22. And from there, all he said was, "Look unto me and be saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God, and there was no one else." Did not expound too much on it. Very hesitantly, he spoke these words. Very nervously, up there, couldn't wait to get down. It brings it back to another story I'll tell you about in a minute, too. But anyhow, so the crowd dispersed, and thinking that the day's service was a loss, but what they did not realize, back in the way back, getting out of the cold weather, there was a 15-year-old boy who ducked into the room, and he heard the words from Isaiah chapter 45 and 22. And it's all he heard. "Look unto me and be saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God and there is no one else." Years later, this boy told the story of how that day he came to know Christ as his Savior from that thing, from those passages. And the boy's name was Charles Haddon Spurgeon, who in the 1800s was known as the Prince of Preachers. He had thousands of people that would come and hear him when he was only 18 and 19 years old. And he wrote concerning this, he says, "Don't hold back because you cannot preach in St. Paul's, but be contented to talk to one or two in a cottage. You may cook in small pots as well as in big ones. Let pigeons carry great messages. Even a little dog can bark at a thief and wake up the master and save the house. Do what you do right thoroughly. Pray over it heartily and leave the results to God." This is what I tell you today. Don't worry about results. Proclaim the gospel. Tell it. If you can't tell it, let your actions speak about who you are. And be proud of who you are as well. Christ died on the cross to save you, an ordinary person. Tell it. Again, if you can't, just let others know. You don't have to be the Apostle Paul. You don't have to be a Billy Graham. Just be you. Don't try to be someone you're not. Be who God wants you to be. Because he's calling you to go out and do what maybe someone else can't do. You know, I can only go in so many places. You can only go in so many places, and so can you. But we all go in different places. And all of us can reach or tell to different people the gospel. And it doesn't matter whether it's one or two. It doesn't have to be of many. Ordinary things that God does. And this is what I want us to look at from here, from this perspective as well. You know, just like that man who was hesitantly proclaimed the word of God. As you know, some of you know Brent Frazier. Well, he was the same way at one time. You know, when he got up here to preach many, many years ago, he said he had butterflies and he thought he could not do it. Well, today he's doing a lot more work, even in Tennessee, and doing things that God wants him, and of course, Joe Frazier, as some of you do know them. God works all of these things out. But notice now, from Exodus chapter 3, notice the first six verses. First of all, God uses the ordinary to meet the needs of his people. You see, what you need to understand here is that Moses needed to meet Jehovah God, the one true God. And look at how God reveals himself to Moses. Now, Moses was tending the flocks of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the far side of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. Then there an angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw, though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight, why this bush does not burn up. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, here I am. He says, do not come any closer. Take off your sandals, so the place you are standing is holy ground. And then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid. Look upon God. Such an awesome sight. Now, what we need to understand here, first of all, is that if you notice, it says that Moses' father-in-law, Jethro, was the priest of Midian. Now, understand, he was the priest of a Baal or a foreign god, a false god. He was not the priest of the one true God. The Midians did not worship the one true God. They worship false gods. And so now for 40 years, Moses, or let's just say the second 40 years, the first 40 years, Moses was indoctrinated or was taught about the Egyptian gods. Now for the next 40 years, he's being told or being taught the things of this false god that is not really the one true God. So when he says he's a priest of Midian, he's the priest of these Baal gods that the Midians or the Midianites actually worship. And also understand, later, the very Midians, they became the enemies of the Israelites and went against the Israelites when Moses brought them back. And God even told him, wipe out all the Midianites because of what they have done to my people Israel. And so here, Moses is growing up from 40 years to 80 years. So for 40 years, he's growing up in this environment. He's married the daughter of one of Jethro. They have two sons. And so now God has called Moses out of this bush. But God took a very insignificant bush, ignited it, and he turned it into a miracle. Why? To get the attention of Moses. Strictly. That's all it was for. Moses. He wanted to talk to Moses. Sure, he could have just appeared unto Moses and talked to him this way here. But God wanted to reveal his power and what he could do and how he could do things. And it dumbfounded Moses as he's looking at this. This bush is on fire, but yet it's not being consumed. It's not burning up. No one has ever seen anything like this. And so here we see the miracle taking place. And God spoke to Moses from the burning bush. If you notice, first it says the angel of the Lord appeared to him, and then God said, and then God called out to him in verse 4, from within the bush. Such an awesome thing. He hears the voice of God just as you hear my voice. We hear each other's voice. He's not hallucinating. He's not dreaming this stuff. This is really happening. And he's dumbfounded concerning what has taken place. Now, remember, although Moses was well educated, and he was brought up in the court of Pharaoh the first 40 years, he needed to know also how to come in the very presence of God. See, also, probably being taught or being told about the Baal gods, and they had no form of formality or any reference or anything. But here, when God saw him coming over, he says, take off your sandals, for the place you are standing is holy ground. And what we need to understand is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is a holy God, a God without sin, the very one who created us. And what Moses needed to understand is that he needed to show respect as well as reverence to Jehovah God. And also understand that God here identifies himself to Moses as the God of whom? Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Not the God of Jethro. That's very important to understand. See, because he's not the God of these false gods that he was told about in the second 40 years of his life. He's also not the God that he knew back in Egypt. But he's relating to him who he is. He is the living God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Such an awesome thing. You know, sometimes God uses ordinary things in life to get our attention. Think about what God has done maybe in your life and how he got your attention just by maybe some little insignificant, ordinary thing that took place in your life. This is what God, how God does things sometimes. And here to make himself known to you by these little ordinary things that we probably don't even take much measure into. Like the uneducated deacon who was not very eloquent in his speech. And yet Spurgeon came to know him. And yet we see, maybe you know a people, no musical experience whatsoever, but yet can sing praises and glory to the Lord. A boy with a sling and a rock and slays a giant with the praise of God. Or how about the boy with the fish and a few loaves? And there Jesus takes and multiplies it and feeds thousands of people, you see. And many other incidences that we think is just ordinary things, but here God does it. For what reason? To reveal himself to people. To show who he is and how he is and what he does as well. And then there's the plain wooden cross that was common back in the Roman days. And on this plain wooden cross, God died for our sins so that we could have salvation. Ordinary, but yet extraordinary as well. Now, again, remember, you say it's nothing significant, but yet it was. Because you see, at the end, when Christ died on the cross, who was it that recognized him to be the Son of God? It was a Roman soldier who said, truly, he was the Son of God. Just by dying on the cross. Now, how many times had this Roman soldier saw a person die on a Roman cross? Probably hundreds of times. And yet, this one puts it into his memory. And he realizes, or being shown by Jehovah God, this is all of God because of this ordinary thing that took place. It was very significant. Like the ordinary bush that got Moses' attention, so too, again, there are ordinary things or ordinary things that get our attention and even the attention of the nation today. look at what has taken place over the years. Just by little ordinary things that we probably don't think much of. But yet, when looked at, said, wow. And so Moses goes over to examine the strange sight and why this bush was not consumed. And what does he hear? He hears the voice of God. He recognizes that it is the voice of God as God has told him. And as he goes over there as well, and as God again reveals to him, take off your sandals, the place you're at is holy ground. Because wherever God is, it's a holy place. It is a place without sin. It is a place of perfection. Such an awesome God that we have. Secondly, not only did God want or need to have Moses meet him and for them to talk. Notice, secondly, in verses 7 through 9, God uses the ordinary to reveal his plans and what he wants. He reveals things. Notice he said, and the Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hands of the Egyptians and bring them up out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me. I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So again, we see here the ordinary taking place here. From out of this little ordinary bush, God here reveals to Moses the plans for his people. He has heard their cry. He has seen the misery that they have gone through over these over 400 years. He was concerning it. But you know, now was a time of God's deliverance. Now God was going to deliver his people from the bondage of slavery, just as he had told Abraham he would. This is not something that was new, and the people probably have forgotten. But anyhow, God told Abraham that the people would be enslaved for over 400 years, and then he would rescue them from the hands of those that they were enslaved with. And this comes out of Genesis chapter 15 and verse 13 and following. One day when Abraham and God had a conversation as well. And he said, then the Lord said to him, know for certain, your descendants will be strangers in a country, not their own. They will be enslaved and mistreated 400 years. But I will punish the nation that serve as slaves, and afterwards they will come out with great possessions. You, however, will go to your fathers, he told him, to Abraham, in peace and be buried at a good old age. In the fourth generation of your descendants will come back here, for the sins of the Amorites have not yet reached its full measure. You see, everything God does is on his timetable and according to how he wants things done. And this is why the first 40 years of Moses' life in Egypt, when he wanted to do things himself and retaliate and go against the Egyptians for the Hebrew, it wasn't yet time for him to do this. He still had some learning to do. He was still probably too proud and everything because of himself being an Egyptian prince and the authority and the position that he held. And now he's on the back side of it. Now he's 80 years old here. And now God reveals to him, Moses, understand, while you were in Egypt, and you remember when all of the people were enslaved, and still are, I heard them. I was not deaf. I was not blind to what I saw. I heard their cries. I saw the misery, and I heard the prayers of my people. And he tells them, he says, I'm coming to rescue them. Again, remember how so many for rescue as well, even in the past and even in the future as well. Noah, how he built the ark and rescued by the power of God. Jacob, Daniel, remember Daniel in the lion's den and how God rescued him. Elijah, Peter, Paul and Silas as they were in jail. And last but not least, you and I. For those of us today who know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, He rescued us from sin, from the power of sin and slavery, by His death on the cross. Such an awesome God that we have. How many times has God rescued you and I? Not only from sin, but from just different things in our lives today. When you go back, think about it. I don't care how long you have lived, whether you have lived only a few years, a lot of years, or whatever. Think about how many times God has rescued you and myself from different situations or different things. How many times has He picked us up and He put us on solid ground? And you know, He still uses ordinary things to reveal His plans. And what is the ordinary thing that many people don't take mind to these days? His Word, the Bible. The Bible. The very same thing that's not allowed in schools anymore or in different other places. The Bible, His Word, it's revealed. And again, you go back to the ordinary thing like the cross. This was God's plan. And what has He done? He has revealed that to all the nations. Every place you go, people have heard some 2,000 years ago what took place in the cross and how it's still being translated as well as being proclaimed everywhere you go about the cross and that of Christ as well. It all began in the Word of God. And even what Peter, as he got up on Pentecost, and he proclaimed concerning, again, the cross and this ordinary thing, he related to the people of that day in Acts chapter 2 and verse 22 and following. Men of Israel, listen to me. Jesus of Nazareth, a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs which God did among you through Him, as you yourselves know, this man was handed over to you by God's set purpose and foreknowledge. And you, with the help of wicked men, put to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because why? It was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. And then he also, from there as well, that we see in Colossians chapter 1, we also read concerning what God here has said from His Word as well. In Colossians chapter 1 and verse 15 and following, who is Christ? Who is this one who died on the cross? In Colossians chapter 1 and verse 15, he says, He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation, for by Him things were created, things in heaven, things on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authority, all things were created by Him and for Him. He was before all things, and in Him all things hold together. And He is the head of the body in the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn among the dead, so that that in everything He might have supremacy. For God was pleased to have all of His fullness dwell in Him, and through Him to reconcile to Himself all things, whether on earth or things in heaven, by making peace, how? Through His blood shed on the cross. Such an awesome God that we have, revealing things to people. And then the third thing that we see from this conversation and this episode of this miracle with the burning bush between God and Moses is in verse 10 through 15, is that God uses the ordinary to save his people, that is, ordinary people, to save other people, to reveal the plan of God, or to even share the gospel. Notice as he so speaks to Moses in verses 10 and following, as he reveals his plans, and then he tells Moses, I want you to go and do this. I want you to go back to Egypt, as he tells him. Then he says, so now, go, I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people Israel out of Egypt. But Moses said to him, wait a minute, God. Wait a minute. Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the people of Israel? God said, I will be with you, and this will be a sign to you that it is that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. So, in other words, Moses was to go all the way back to Egypt where he came from over, 80 years ago, or 40 years ago, and come back to this mountain again to bring the people to worship God. But Moses said to God, suppose I go to Israel and they say, hey, the God of your fathers has sent me, and they ask me, what is your name? What shall I tell them? And God said to Moses, I am what I am. This is what you are to say to them. I am has sent you. God also said to Moses, say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent you. This is my name forever, the name by which I am to be remembered from generation to generation. Isn't this amazing? At this point in Moses' life, 80 years old, he is just an ordinary man. He is a sheep herder. He's a man married again with a wife and two children. He is no longer the prince of Egypt that he once used to be. He is no longer this respected man among the Egyptians. No longer is he of any importance to anyone except God. God is sending this man back to where he came to bring his people out of Egypt, back to the mountain of God, 80 years old. The first 40, he lived in Egypt. The second 40, he lived in the desert. And now he's going back at 80 years old to do the work of God. Don't ever think that you're either too young or you're too old to do things for God. You know, it's always amazing to me when I hear that people say, well, I'm retiring and I'm not going to do anything. Or as a believer, we never really retire, because our life is always on display. Because we're always showing and telling people who we are, what we are, and how we do things. Because of Christ who lives in us. Moses didn't think himself qualified to do this. Matter of fact, if you go in chapter 4 later and you read all the excuses he made. I cannot speak. I can't do this. I can't do these things. Lord, you got the wrong person. You know, I knew a guy that did the same thing 35 years ago. Told the Lord the same thing. The wrong person. And he was wrong just as Moses is wrong. God can use ordinary people to do his work. Don't ever think and say, I can't. If God is calling you into service or to do something, don't say, I can't. Just say, Lord, what do you want me to do? He'll give you the ability to do it, the power in which to do it. Just as he, God, was in this bush, he wanted Moses to go back. And just as God was here firing it up, he was going to fire Moses up as well. See, it wasn't going to be because of Moses' ability or power. It's going to be by the power of God in Moses to do what God wanted him to do. And this is what we need to understand as well. It's not just me, it's all of us together. And God uses every one of us to show others the things he planned. God had plans for Moses. Moses was this weak bush, but God was going to empower him with fire. Why him? God was going to empower him. He was going to use this weak vessel that Moses thought he was to reveal himself to Pharaoh as well as to the rest of the world. And you want to know what? It worked. It worked. Over 40 more years later, 60 or 70 more years later, you remember when Joshua went to Jericho and he sent the spies to the house of Rahab, the prostitute. And what was the first thing she told them? She said, I heard about what happened. I heard about how and what God had done back in Egypt. Now, when you read that, remember, this happened years and years and years ago, before she was even born, probably. And yet, the people were still talking about what God had done to the Egyptians by this ordinary person of Moses. And what took place. How they crossed the Red Sea on dry ground. And what happened to all the Egyptians as well. Amazing of how God uses ordinary things to do extraordinary things. Not only in our lives, but in the lives of other people as well. So that they can come to know Him as Lord and Savior. And what did Rahab do? She put her faith and her trust in the one true God. Why? Because of an ordinary thing that took place. And yet, to them it was extraordinary, which it was. The miracle that took place. And they never forgot it because it was the power of God. And they knew it. That this was the one true God who could do all things. God uses ordinary to do extraordinary things for His glory and to save people as well. You don't believe it? Look at Bayou Baptist Church. How many extraordinary things has God done since you have been here? You know, here at Bayou Baptist Church, we've been through many, many things here. We've been through flood. We've been through fires. And yet God is still working here in the midst of it. Such ordinary things that we think about. But yet, to me, it's a miracle each and every day. Because I look at this place and I see the work and the hand of God working. And to other people, it may be just an ordinary thing. But we are a witness to other people of what God can and would do. And here, Moses is the same way. Moses thinking as he left Egypt 40 years ago that he would reside himself. This is what I'm going to do. But God said, no, here's what I want you to do. I want you to go back and do this. God may have plans for you as well. But the first plan you need to understand is this. You need to come to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. In your heart. Now you may know Him intellectually. You may maybe you've even read about Him in the Word. Maybe somebody's even told you about Him. But the question is, does He live in your heart and your life? Have you repented of your sin and come to the knowledge of Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? That's the first place you start. And after that, you'll see the ordinary things that God does. Or even maybe before that, of how God does certain things. And you look and say, wow. This was all of God and His working out everything. And why? For His glory and your salvation. Since you come to know Him. But the question is, do you know Him as Lord and Savior? Today you can do that. You can come to know Him as your Lord and your Savior by just repenting of your sin and putting faith in Him. Let us stand. Almighty God, as we come now to any all who come to know You, or You calling, just as You called so many others, and they need to come to have You in their hearts and their lives, that they've not done that. And if You are speaking to them today, just as You spoke to Moses from the burning bush, Lord, if You are speaking to them, I pray they will heed Your voice, and they will come. And they will put You in their hearts and in their lives. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Turn to hymn number 280. As we sing this, and if God is speaking to you today, you come as we sing 280, Jesus Keep Me, near the cross. We do have food, so you can come about 6:15, 6:30. This Wednesday, I think it's jambalaya, chicken and sausage jambalaya. What else is going to go with that, I don't know. This is what I do know as far as what we're going to have, and plus Bible study. So come about 6:15, 6:30, somewhere around there. Have some food, we don't have to worry about cooking, and then we have fellowship, and then we'll have Bible study. Women's have one class and the men's have another class. It seems like they have more women than they do men. That's okay. We don't hold that against them. But you can come on Wednesday night if you'd like and come and join us for food and fellowship and Bible study as well at 7 or 6:15, 6:30. If not, come next week. Sunday school, 9 o'clock. Worship service, 10:30. Come and worship with us in spirit and truth as we worship the one true God. Jesus Christ. I pray God's blessing upon each and every one. Have a safe day and a safe week as well as you journey in life today. Al, lead us in a closing prayer.
Heavenly Father, again, we come before you thanking you for all that you've done for us. And Father, it's the word today that each and every person here is useful to you. And the Father, you have a job for each and every person. Sometimes we don't feel that way because, Father, we ourselves maybe expect more of ourselves. But you know us. And Father, you'll give us the knowledge, the strength, the know-how to do what you call upon each and every one of us to do. I pray, Lord, that you will be with us as we go our separate ways. Bring us back to worship again together. In thy Son's precious name we pray.
I pray that if God has spoken to you today, whether here or you looking at this on Facebook or YouTube, and if you need further counseling or if you would like to talk to someone and you live locally here, you can call at the church at 985-214-9343. And feel free to call, but if you're out of town or if you don't live near here, seek your local pastor or minister and talk to them further about your own eternal life, we only have today. So if you would like to seek or to talk to someone, feel free, call us and let us know if we can help you in your eternal life, your salvation, your relationship with the Lord as well.